Hello, everyone. It's 8 o'clock, and we're going to start our semester two review session for biology, part two. We're going to talk about energy and ecosystems and infectious disease. So hopefully you can hear me. I'll just wait for people to start filling up the room. Play some music while we're waiting for people to join in. If I could have somebody test the question link and just make sure you can hear me and that this ask a question link is working, I'd greatly appreciate it. Thank you. Yes, I will be going over those questions, Jeffrey. And if I do not get one of those questions answered, feel free to ask that question with the live question link. But I will try to answer those questions you put down. Are those questions you put down ones on the second two units, energy and ecosystems, bacteria, viruses, immune system, or were they questions from evolution and genetics? Right, we'll wait one more minute till 8:05 to see if more people show up. I know you might have a low attendance tonight due to the World History AP exam tomorrow and the Human Geography AP exam on Friday. Okay, I'll start with the infectious disease and energy and ecosystems questions. I'll swing back and get the evolution and genetics questions at the end of the presentation, since that was gone over on Monday. But we should have some time to cover those questions too today. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started here. So the second two units that will be on the final exam are going to be talking about energy and ecosystems. And in this section, we talked about how energy flows and travels through an ecosystem along with the materials, the matter, the carbon, the hydrogen, the oxygen, and how that moves through an ecosystem. And then we also talked about photosynthesis and cell respiration, not in great detail, but we'll cover the detail that you need to know for the final. We did talk about predator-prey relationships, so I'll make sure I grab a graph for that. Roles and trophic levels, definitely cover that as well. So I think we will cover all this stuff. And if, again, more questions come up during this presentation, feel free to ask them on the question link that's listed. So first, let's talk about the difference between a food chain and a food web. Both diagrams show how energy flow, and that's a big key. Energy flows through an ecosystem. A food chain is more of a linear path, where we start down here with the producers, and producers are the organisms that are able to capture energy. Usually it's from the sun, and that energy from the sun is then converted into a chemical form of energy for other organisms in that ecosystem to use. So the primary producers are usually photosynthesizers, and they photosynthesize to take light energy, convert it into sugar, so they can use that sugar energy in their cells to power themselves and do all the things that cells have to do, all the processes of life that are required, that require energy. But these primary producers are often consumed by other organisms. We call those other organisms consumers. Consumers take those primary producers and they eat them. And when they eat those primary producers, they get not only carbon, but they get their organic, or they get their energy as well. So the one reason why consumers eat producers is to get energy, but the other reason is to get the carbon compounds they need to build all the molecules that they need to build. So this linear pathway just shows how the energy flows from one organism to the next, like primary producers to primary consumers, secondary consumers, and so forth. So these trophic level terms just kind of tell us where they are at in that path or that flow of energy. There are other terms that we talked about. For example, this mollusk would be considered a herbivore by definition because it's eating a primary producer. If you look over here at this food web, we can look at several herbivores that are pictured, like this squirrel and this mouse and this bird. Based on this diagram, they are only getting energy from the primary producers down here, which is the grass. So herbivores eat, you know, producers. And then we have carnivores, for example, like this fox or this owl or this snake. They are usually top-level consumers, either secondary or tertiary, and they are getting energy from other consumers. They don't eat the plants directly. They get the energy by eating other consumers that ate the plant. Now, we do have some examples, though I don't think we have any drawn here. If I were to draw an arrow maybe from this grass, to this robin, then this robin, which I don't think it really is, but this, if there was an arrow going from the grass to the robin and from this beetle, the robin, then the robin would be considered an omnivore. It eats both consumers and producers. So those vocabulary terms are also important to know. Carnivore, herbivore, and omnivore. Now, the big difference between a food chain and a food web is that a food web shows many food chains and how the food chains interact. Usually, in most ecosystems, it's not a food chain that only exists. It's several food chains that coexist together, showing many different interactions, many different food sources, many different energy pathways in this ecosystem. Now, this food web also shows that whenever organisms die or give off waste, that energy that's stored in their bodies or in their waste products eventually end up being consumed by the decomposers. So eventually, almost all the energy in an ecosystem does end up going to those decomposers. But the key is that those decomposers don't recycle the energy. They only recycle matter. We'll talk about that later. But the energy is always going to be given off as heat. And that leads us to talking about a pyramid model. We talked a lot about pyramid models in this unit. Pyramids are a great visual representation of what goes on in an ecosystem. A ecosystem is a transfer event, or in an ecosystem, there's a transfer of energy from the primary producers, the primary consumers, all the way up to sometimes a quaternary consumer. But that energy is not transferred 100%, or not 100% of that energy is transferred. A lot of it is given off as heat. And the reason why it's given off as heat is because organisms use the energy. You know, when a mouse eats a producer, the mouse doesn't store all that energy it ate. It uses actually most of it to build molecules and to basically do things to stay alive. So that energy that's lost is lost as heat. So only about, and scientists have done many calculations to figure this out, we use this concept of this 10% rule, that only about 10% of the energy available in one level is able to be transferred to the next level for the next group of consumers. So of this 20,000 kilocalories of energy stored here, only about 2,000 moves up to the next level. Only about 200 of that moves up to the second consumers, and only about 200 of that 20,000 ends up in the tertiary consumers, and only about 2 kilocalories of that original 20,000 trickles its way up to the quaternary consumers, because most of that is given off as heat and waste products at every level. But like I said, eventually all that energy that's not given off as heat ends up being converted or transferred to the consumers, which also give off energy as heat because they go through cell respiration just like other consumers do. And that energy never cycles back to the light, which was the original source of that energy. That's a big, important concept when talking about how energy flows through an ecosystem. It never recycles back. So we see energy flows from sunlight and flows out as heat. It never goes back to the sun. So it comes in from the sun, producers convert it to chemical forms in glucose and other organic molecules. Herbivores eat those producers. Carnivores eat the herbivores. These organisms eventually all die. They decompose. In that transfer, though, energy is constantly being given off as heat, and that heat just radiates out to the universe, never to come back again. So it's a one-way flow. So we're constantly needing to supply our planet, our ecosystems, with energy. The sun has to constantly be shining to keep ecosystems alive. Without the sun, energy would not be transferred or not flow through ecosystems, and organisms would essentially die. That's why we need a constant supply of energy. Now, matter, the organic molecules, on the other hand, are recycled over and over again. Most of the matter, I mean, some of it might be lost as it floats away through the atmosphere, but most of it has been on this planet forever, for as long as life has been on this planet, and it's just been cycled from one organism to another. So someone asked this question right here, can you go over the carbon cycle? So let's use that as an example in this picture right here. So let's take producers. So there's carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Producers bring that carbon in through the process of photosynthesis. So photosynthesis brings it in. And then when an herbivore eats the producer, eats a plant, that carbon is transferred to the herbivore. The herbivore uses those organic molecules to build its own molecules. So the molecules a rabbit needs is going to be built from the carbon that the plant got from carbon dioxide. And then when a carnivore eats the herbivore, it takes that carbon and converts it into its own molecules. And the carbon then eventually gets transferred to decomposers. But all the while, when we break down molecules for energy, we give it off as carbon dioxide. And that carbon dioxide is given back off to the atmosphere. Even plants do this. We saw that in our photosynthesis lab, that a plant that's not photosynthesizing is still giving off CO2. And so the molecules are just being recycled. Carbon is not lost. Carbon is not doesn't flow. It's cycled. Even decomposers take all the dead organic material, all these dead organisms, they go through cell respiration and they send that carbon back into the atmosphere as well. So carbon has been recycled for eons. So the carbon molecules that make up your body at one point could have been making up any other living organism. You might have carbon in you that was found in a dinosaur for all we know, because it's been recycled over and over again through the carbon cycle. Okay, this person asks, how's the loss of trees affect the carbon cycle or CO2 level? That's a great ecology question. When trees are not pulling carbon dioxide into the ecosystem, one, they're not providing it to the herbivores, which are not providing it to the carnivores. So we're not getting that intake of carbon. And two, we get too much carbon dioxide in our atmosphere, and that has led to things like global warming, which has led to climate change. So trees are a major organism that brings the carbon out of the atmosphere, keeping the levels normal, and providing that carbon for all the organic molecules that need to be made for herbivores and carnivores to consume and make part of their bodies. So trees are, you know, and other plants are really important because they bring the carbon in to the ecosystem. So photosynthesis. A lot of you have a general concept of what photosynthesis is. At least I hope you do. You're not going to have to memorize the equation, but you do need to know like how the equation works. So for example, people usually know when, you know, when I look at an equation, these are the reactants. These are what are going into the reaction, and these are what come out. So carbon dioxide goes in, water goes in, glucose comes out, oxygen comes out. We need light energy to make the process happen. That's like a basic level understanding of photosynthesis. But we're going to require you to know a little bit deeper and a little bit more about what photosynthesis is than just that. So we talked about, and you're not gonna, don't forget, freaked out by this picture. We're not going to make you memorize the whole thing. But we did talk about there are two main parts to photosynthesis. There is the part that uses light energy, and then there's the part that uses carbon dioxide, which is called the Calvin cycle. And so the light-dependent reactions, we take that light energy, we capture it in these things called chloroplasts in the cell. And these chloroplasts have these little tiny discs called thylakoids that have chlorophyll on them. They capture that light energy, and in doing so, they use water, and they can take that energy and store it temporarily as these high-energy molecules called ATP and NADPH. Again, that's not going to be a part of the final, but it's the energy has now been converted from light to a chemical form. A waste product of that reaction is oxygen. So a lot of people think, you know, plants make oxygen for us, and that's true, but that's not why plants are photosynthesizing. They're photosynthesizing to take this energy in light and convert it to a chemical form. Well, now we have to store that chemical form of energy. We have to store it in a molecule that will last for a long time, and that's done by the Calvin cycle. The Calvin cycle takes in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and then that turns that carbon dioxide into, don't worry about this G3P, we're just going to call this a sugar. And so eventually the light energy comes from the sun, converted by the chloroplasts into a chemical form, and then stored in a carbon-rich molecule called glucose using carbon dioxide as our storage. So it's almost like putting money into an envelope. The money is the energy. The envelope is made out of carbon or carbon dioxide. So you take your money and you store it in an envelope for later. And that's kind of what photosynthesis is. So in photosynthesis, okay, now you should know when you look at the equation, the carbon in carbon dioxide eventually gets stored in the glucose molecule that is the product of the reaction, and that the solar energy, the light energy, is also stored in this glucose. We just have to use water as a reactant, and we give off oxygen as a waste for this process to happen. Now, when we talked about cell respiration, that's kind of just the reverse process. Our cells have mitochondria in them, which you all know is the powerhouse of the cell. But what our mitochondria do, they take that glucose molecule, and with oxygen, they are able to then convert that into a form of energy that our cells can use called ATP. ATP powers all the cellular work that the cell has to do. And so that ATP is like energy currency. It's money. The cell has to spend so many ATPs to divide, to copy its DNA, to make a protein. That all requires ATP, just like you have to spend money to do things. So when cells break down glucose, they make ATP, but in that process, they give off carbon dioxide and water as a waste product, which is then, you can see, the carbon is cycled. So the real simple carbon cycle is really going from CO2, photosynthesis takes it in, makes it organic molecules like sugars. Our mitochondria take those organic molecules, break that apart, and we give it back as CO2. Carbon is cycled. Yet energy starts up here as light, gets captured into organic molecules, and then released as ATP to power cellular work. In that process, some of it is wasted as heat, and that heat, again, radiates away, never to return to the system. So energy flows through a system. This green box represents the ecosystem. It's a system. And the carbon cycles through the system, within the system. It never leaves. Energy flows, organic molecules, or I should say carbon, cycles. And that's happening all throughout the entire planet. We talked about other nutrient cycles that are important, but the final exam is really just going to focus on carbon. So the sun provides the energy to the producers. Producers pass that energy on to consumers, and the energy goes to decomposers eventually. Even the energy from the producers when they die go to decomposers, given off as heat. So there's your energy flow. Flows through, never goes back to the sun. However, the entire time, this green arrow represents carbon, or just nutrients in general, and those nutrients cycle through the ecosystem, always staying within the earth. So there's your carbon cycle. We're not going to really make you worry about memorizing terms except for photosynthesis and respiration. But again, carbon gets pulled in through, let me take a look at this picture. Photosynthesis is right here. It gets sent back out through respiration. Now, there are other means of sending up CO2. You know, volcanic eruptions like the ones happening in Hawaii right now. Volcanic eruptions send up CO2. Human emissions, burning of coal, oil, other fossil fuels, and wood send up CO2. But a lot of this carbon cycle you might be looking at, we're not going to really worry about. This is the main part right here that we talked about in our class, how photosynthesis brings it in, soil respiration sends it back out into the atmosphere. So let me go check the screen here for any other questions. I don't see any. So we're going to move on to, let me go back and make sure I answered all questions that were asked in the original slide here. So the importance of producers in the ecosystem, they provide two things. They provide a source of energy. They convert energy from light to a chemical form for all living things to use. And they provide a source of organic molecules. They provide a source of carbon and other important nutrients like nitrogen and so forth. Trophic levels are just the level in which you are feeding and the ecosystem. So it's like the place you are at. It's kind of like the idea of a niche or a niche. It's like where you're at in the food chain. Examples of producers, yes, are protists and plants. Those are examples of producers. Now, as far as consumers, they're important because they transfer energy. In fact, they're not as important as producers, because if honestly consumers were wiped off the face of the planet, the producers would be just fine as long as there are still decomposers around. So these consumers, not that important, as important as producers. But producers do have their steps in the food chain, whereas a primary consumer needs to be present for a secondary consumer to consume. Predator-prey relationships. I got to look up a graph for this. Give me one second here. Hopefully I'm spelling this right. Here's a good graph. So the person that asked about the predator-prey relationship. When you look at the predator-prey relationship, here's how it works. I know my class did this lab. So we actually got, we were able to graph this relationship. I'm not sure about other classes, but basically the way a predator-prey graph works is that usually the prey increases first. There's a low number of predators. The prey is able to increase because they're not being eaten. There's plenty of resources. They go up, but in doing so, there is now more food available, more energy available, more biomass available for the predator population. So in response to the prey increase, the predators increase as well. But as the predators increase, they are consuming more and more prey. And so eventually you get to a point where the prey top out because now there's a lot of predators and their population starts to crash because these predators are now at a high population. They're eating a lot. And so their numbers drop. In response to that, the predators start running out of food and then their population drops. But as they drop, the prey then kind of rebound and go back up. And in response to that, the predators go back up. So the predator-prey relationship is that they affect each other based on the fact the prey are eaten by the predators, and the predators require the energy for the prey, or energy from the prey. So that's a kind of a example or description of the predator-prey relationship. Okay, let me go back and see if there's any other questions. Importance of decomposers. Well, decomposers do two things, but their importance really relies on the fact that they are constantly supplying not energy, but the organic molecules from the dead organisms and the dead organisms' waste back to the producers to use. So new producers can be made or can grow because they need organic molecules and inorganic molecules like carbon dioxide to grow. And so the decomposers send CO2 back up. They also send other organic inorganic molecules like nitrogen and so forth, so the producers can use it. So that's the important. They're like the recyclers of the ecosystem. Okay, products of respiration, which are waste and which are used by the cell. So looking at respiration, respiration is going this way. I'm assuming when you say three products, you're talking also about ATP. ATP energy is used by the cell. The water is probably used by the cell too, but that's really not important. But the important thing is that carbon dioxide is a waste product of cell respiration that is breathed out or released back into the atmosphere. Now, when you go the direction of photosynthesis, oxygen is the waste product of photosynthesis, and glucose is the actual product that is trying to be made by plants and other photosynthesizers. All right, I think that covers all the ecology-based questions. Let me take a look and see if any more questions popped up on our question sheet here. All right, let's go over infectious disease then. So what is an antibiotic resistance lab show us about bacterial evolution? We'll definitely talk about that, but we'll talk about that at the very end. How are bacteria treated once they have caused an infection? We'll definitely talk about that as well. And we'll talk about pathogenic bacteria versus virus and how they cause illnesses. So let's first talk about what prevents us from getting sick, and that's the immune system. Now, in my class, we talked about the innate and the adaptive immune system. Some people refer to it as the non-specific versus the specific, but I like the term innate because it kind of means it's always working. It's always on. It's always protecting you. It doesn't have to it works the same way every time. So it's not specific, I guess, which is why it's called the non-specific immune system, to how it works. It's always there. So I know these terms are kind of confusing. Epithelial barriers, that's just skin. So don't worry about that. It's just a good picture. So your skin provides boundaries, either the skin on the surface of your body or the lining of many of your trachea and your other openings have barriers as well. You also have phagocytes in your cell, in your body that gobble up bacteria or viruses. Don't worry about these down here. But those are part of your innate immune system. And then you have your adaptive immune system where you have B cells and T cells. And these, when they experience a pathogen like a bacteria or a virus, they adapt, they learn, they change, and will produce antibodies and cytotoxic T cells that will go after that specific invader and try to clear the infection. Now, your innate immunity is quick to react, very fast, because they work the same way every time. There's no learning that takes place. Whereas the adaptive immune system is very slow. It takes days, even weeks sometimes for them to work, but they're more powerful because they will produce a lot of antibodies and T cells to help clear the body of infection. So the question about viruses, Someone asked how do viruses infect the body? Well, we got to first talk about a virus itself. So a virus is real simple. It's just some nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA, surrounded by a protein coat called a capsid. Some viruses have these envelopes around them. And the important thing we talked about these envelopes is that they have these little proteins that stick out of them. And that allows the virus to attach to the cell that it's infecting. The thing about these proteins is that they're really specific. For example, a virus that infects a plant won't infect you because it doesn't have the right proteins on its surface to get into your cells. We watched a video in class about this lock and key idea of the influenza virus and how some influenza viruses have the right keys to get into human cells, and some don't. And there's a worry that some of those that don't right now will mutate and change and eventually will be able to open up human cells. But those are the parts of the virus. And that's one reason why viruses are not considered living things is because they're not made up of a cell. They don't have ribosomes. They don't have ways of breaking down energy or molecules for food or molecules for energy. All they have is a set of instructions. That's all a virus really is. It's a set of instructions. But they are instructions on how to make more viruses, and that's what an infection is. An infection is a virus getting those instructions inside of a cell, taking over the host cell, causing the host cell to produce more viruses, and then those viruses break out, killing the host cell, and they go off to infect new cells. So how infection works is that a virus somehow has to attach, has to have the right proteins to recognize that specific cell. If it does, it then somehow gets in. Either the whole virus goes in or just the DNA goes in. It doesn't really matter. The instructions get in. So there's DNA or the RNA gets into the cell. Once inside the cell, that genetic material is copied and that genetic material is used to make viral genomes, DNA or RNA, and viral proteins. And so this is the hijacking part. This is how the cell is taken over by the virus. The virus turns the cell into a little virus factory. Those viruses are then assembled, and then the viruses are released, which is kind of a nice way of saying they burst out of the host cell, and they go on to infect nearby cells, causing more death and more destruction. We did talk about the difference between lytic and lysogenic cycle. However, that's really not a focus for the final exam, so you don't have to worry too much about that. But just know generally that when a virus causes disease, it's getting inside of your cells, causing the cells to make more viruses, causing those cells then to die, which is what your illness is. It's just your cells are dying. Now, bacteria work a little bit differently. We talked about the difference between bacteria and viruses. One big difference is that a bacteria is a cell. It's just one cell, so it's not multicellular like we are, but they do have a cell membrane. They do have genetic material. They do have cytoplasm. They do have little tiny ribosomes to build proteins. And they have this unique thing called a cell wall. Cell walls give bacteria their resistance to, it's kind of like their barrier to the outside world. It's like almost like their skin in a sense. It protects them. And their cell walls have different shapes. Like we talked about the spherical shapes, the rod shapes, the spiral shapes. These are called cocci and bacilli and spirillia. Terms that aren't too important for the final. But these bacteria cells cause infection very differently. They don't get into your cells. They just reproduce inside your body. And so they will starve your cells of nutrients. They will release toxins that can damage or hurt your cells. They don't actually get inside of your cells, though. Only viruses do. And so your body has different ways of attacking a bacteria. Bacteria, going back to this adaptive immune system, a bacteria will be attacked by just antibodies. The cytotoxic T cells don't really do anything because there's no cells that are infected. Whereas a virus will be attacked by both antibodies and these cytotoxic T cells, along with the phagocytic cells, the cells that eat things. They'll gobble up any bacteria or virus they come in contact. Doesn't matter what it is, they'll just gobble it up regardless. They gobble up any pathogen that's present. The one thing that we have learned about treating viruses and bacteria is that antibiotics only work on a bacteria because antibiotics affect the way the bacteria function. Antibiotics can go after how DNA is copied. Antibiotics can go after how the cell wall is made. Antibiotics can go after how proteins are made. that doesn't work on a virus because the virus doesn't do those things. Viruses don't copy their DNA. Viruses don't make proteins. Viruses don't have a cell wall to produce. So antibiotics won't help because that's not what viruses do. It's like giving medicine that's not effective. That's not going to cause the virus to not do something. We do have antiviral drugs, however, that have been used to prevent viruses from, for example, attaching. So if we can prevent the virus from attaching to the cell, that medication will help prevent a viral infection. That's what a lot of antiviral drugs actually do. Or if we prevent the viral DNA from being copied, that will be an effective treatment. But antibiotics don't do that. Antivirals do. Now, talking about evolution and how we have caused a serious problem. We have caused a serious problem with bacteria evolution because of our use of antibiotics. So here you have three bacteria cells, the blue one, the green one, and the purple one. Let's say you take an antibiotic. Let's say the blue and the purple are resistant to that antibiotic. The green isn't. So the green gets killed, but the blue and the purple survive. You're still sick. So you go back to the doctor and you say, all right, I need something else because I'm not feeling better. The doctor gives you a different antibiotic. And this antibiotic only kills the purple. Well, now you have selected for this blue, very resistant antibiotic to have no competition. So it has free reign. It has all the resources it needs. It's the survivor. It has evolved, or it is evolved, or it is adapted to the environment you gave it. And it survives, reproduces, and the population changes over time. The population evolves to be more resistant to antibiotics. And the overuse and the constant use of antibiotics has led bacteria to evolve as a population and change to be more resistant, which is why we have a hard time fighting certain infections like MRSA and whatnot. Okay, so that was... bacteria, viruses, and immune system in a nutshell. So I believe I answered this question just now. How did the antibiotic resistance lab show us about bacterial evolution? If you look, when you think back to the antibiotic lab, you measured the zone of inhibition. Actually, if I go to the study guide here, I believe, oh, I don't have that. I don't have that question on there. If you go back and look at your lab, let me look up zone of inhibition here. So here's a good example. So we used a bacteria and we tested several different antibiotics on that bacteria and we measured how clear the ring was around the antibiotic disc, and that was where no bacteria grew. It's how strong or how well the antibiotic worked. The bigger the zone, the better the antibiotic worked. The smaller the zone, the more resistant to antibiotics that bacteria was. So in this picture, the whatever antibiotic this is, C, I'm guessing this is maybe penicillin, the P, is not, the bacteria is very resistant to those, where it's not resistant to whatever these antibiotics are. So that's one way of testing to see how resistant bacteria are. Here's another good picture of it too. So the diameter of the zone of inhibition correlates to the sensitivity of the bacteria to the antibiotics. So the bigger the zone, the more sensitive it is. The smaller the zone, the more resistant it is to those antibiotics. Hope that answered that question for you. Okay, describe how pathogenic bacteria cause illness compared to how viruses cause illness. So pathogenic bacteria, they either cause illness by just reproducing inside your body and taking up nutrients, overcrowding cells, causing buildup of pressure. If you've ever seen an infected cut, it's filled with pus and it's red and swollen. That's what bacteria do. Some bacteria produce toxins, or they're toxic themselves, like botulism. They produce a chemical that interferes with the way your cells function, which is very different than viruses. Viruses get inside your cell. They get their instructions, the DNA, the RNA, the code on how to make more viruses. They get that inside the cell, cause the cell to turn into a virus-producing factory, and the cell will eventually die when those viruses break out and go on to infect nearby cells. So that's the big difference. And that's why we have to have different treatments. That's why our immune system acts differently as well to the different kinds of pathogens. Okay, looking for more questions. I don't see any more. So I know, Jeffrey, you said you wanted to go over evolution. I did add some slides. Let me go see what questions. I'm assuming the questions you added would be the ones on the bottom. Four principles of Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection. What's a gene pool? What role does reproduction play in natural selection? So let's talk about gene pool, first of all. So this group of flowers, for example, would be considered a gene pool. It's all the genes, it's all the organisms and their genes that are able to reproduce with each other. So it's an analogy really to all the genetic material available to a population of organisms that can reproduce. And so we look at a population at the genetic level, we can calculate frequencies of how often certain genes appear, like this big W gene for purple flowers versus this little W gene for white flowers. Appears so often, you know, 13 out of 18 times in the gene pool. So one way we can look at evolution is to see, do these allele frequencies change? And if they do, the population has evolved. Not in a big way, in a small way, we call that microevolution, but the offspring show a change in allele frequency, meaning something is causing that change. We watched that Five Fingers Evolution video, and Mr. Anderson, who made that video, talked about the shuffling of a deck. You know, if you shuffle a deck of cards, you still have the same probability of pulling, you know, of every card, because it's just reshuffling the same cards. When you start removing cards, let's say you remove all the hearts, well, now you've increased the likelihood of pulling out a spade because you've removed some of the other cards that aren't spades. So that analogy, when you change how often certain genes appear, that changes the population in a way that the population now is evolving or changing over time. Another way of looking at it like this, I found this picture. I love the Khan Academy images. They're the best. So you start a population of rabbits, and we can calculate allele frequencies. Don't worry, you're not going to have to do that on the final. But let's say, you know, half of the white rabbits die. Well, we've eliminated those genes that made those white rabbits white. In this example, they happen to be recessive. So now we've changed the allele frequency. Half of those little b's are gone. The frequency of alleles have changed. The population will then change to be more brown. And so nature has selected, for whatever reason, could be the white rabbits couldn't find food, they couldn't get away from predators, it could be any number of selective pressures that cause this to happen, but the population is changing. The brown rabbits are now more fit or adapted or have adaptations for that environment if this was done by natural selection. Okay, let me check for questions. Will you have to know the four principles of Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection? We're not going to be looking for them specifically, but we're looking for that, can you apply them? So let me go back to this picture. Here's a good picture of the four principles. So first of all, there has to be variation that exists within a population. So if you look at these butterflies, or you look at these rabbits, you have white rabbits or dark rabbits, you have yellow butterflies or brown butterflies. So there has to be variation. Nature has to have something to choose for or against. So that's one thing you have to know. And then there's going to be competition. Some organisms will do better than others. Some will have better traits. Those better traits, if they help them survive, we call them adaptations. If they have better traits, they are more likely to survive, and more importantly, they're more likely to reproduce. And they pass on those traits to the next generation. If over time this keeps happening, and that's key, this has to happen generation after generation after generation, this happens over and over and over again, there's always that selective pressure, then the population has evolved. The population is also now adapted to its environment because the better traits won out over the not so good traits. So it's more, can you apply the principles than can you just regurgitate them and tell me what they are? I want you to be able to apply them. Well, you have to know the five fingers and in what order. There is no order, first of all. There's no order to them. The only reason why we use the fingers is it helps you remember them. You can go from thumb to pinky, pinky to thumb. Do you have to know all five? Not really. The one that's really important is the thumb, is the idea of natural selection. Because if I go back to this five finger picture, these four, small population, non-random mating, mutations, and gene flow, those are all random. Those don't lead to a better adapted population. They don't lead to organisms being able to survive in their environment. They just randomly happen, but they do cause change. They are part of evolution. It's natural selection, the thumb, that helps populations adapt or allows for adaptations to occur, because now you are having nature select who is better, who is built to survive, and who is not. So memorizing the five fingers, I would not bother memorizing the five fingers. Really just focus on knowing what natural selection is. Okay, let me go back to some other things I want to talk about. I didn't do this in the last review session, so I want to talk about now. There are kind of three ways, general ways, that natural selection can occur. And it's based on, you know, what variations are in the population. So in this picture, you have this dotted line shows the original population. And if you were graphing number of beetles and what kind of color they had, let's say the majority of beetles were some in between light green and dark green color. And for whatever reason, nature is selecting against being light green and against being dark green. There's a better chance of survival if you are a medium green color. Maybe the environment is medium green, dark green stands out, light green stands out. So if you're those colors, you're gonna die and be eaten by birds. But if you're like in between, you're going to blend in, you're going to survive. This is called stabilizing selection, because the average individuals are selected for and they reproduce, and the average grows to be more of the population. You know, there are more average colored beetles than there are light or dark. We're not choosing either extreme. Okay. Then you have directional selection, where this usually happens when something in the environment changes suddenly. Like we also get a new environmental background, or we get a disease or something like that only allows certain individuals to survive. So let's say the environment for some reason turns very dark green. Well, now being light colored and even medium colored is not good for you. Being dark green is favored. Nature is selecting this phenotype, this once not common, but now is adapted. To survive and reproduce, and then the average shifts over in a certain direction. A great example from our class, in my class, we did the rock pocket mouse activity, where at one point there was a population of mice, most of them were tan, because they lived in sand, and you know, they're blended in. There was variation. There were some that were born with a mutation that caused them to be black, but they were selected against at first because they stood out in the desert where there's tan sand. But then there are these lava flows that happened thousands of years ago. And those lava flows left black patches in certain areas. Well, the mice in those areas started to evolve. The black mouse was now at an advantage. The light mouse was now at a disadvantage. And so the population shifted towards the darker variation, towards that selection or that color of fur. That would be directional selection. Now, the last one is always the hardest one to come up with examples for, because it doesn't really happen too often in nature. This idea of disruptive selection, where you have, for some reason, the average is selected against, whereas the extremes are selected for, and you get two different color variations, and that leads to two very different color beetles in this situation. But that's a tough one, and we're not worried about that one for the final exam. All right, so I did talk about this one example on the last review session. Just remember, adaptation doesn't involve trying. Like, you can't adapt as an individual. I can't be like, I want to grow a fur coat so I can go out and run in the winter and be warm. Just like this beaver can't adapt and say, I want to grow a chainsaw for arms so I can cut down trees better. You have to be born with the variation. You have to have genetically inherited the variation from your parents, either through mutation or through natural selection. And then those become adaptations if they help you survive and reproduce. All right, here's just another example of evolution in mosquitoes. Let's say these two red mosquitoes are resistant to this DDT spray. So few mosquitoes have this resistant allele. Most do not. But when we start using a chemical that kills off the ones that do not, these two survive. They reproduce. Survivors reproduce over several generations. And now the population is now immune to that DDT spray. There's more resistant alleles found in the population. Same thing's happening for bacteria. There's more resistant genes in the bacterial population. Then we talked about reading these cladograms, which were in the last review session, so I'm not going to go over those again. Jeffrey, if you're still here, I know you had said you had some questions. Were there any specific genetic questions you'd like me to do? I think I might have found a way to do a whiteboard genetics problem. So if you have specific questions, anybody watching, you have specific questions on genetics, ask them now, or we could be done. I feel like I've kind of covered everything that needs to be covered for the final. Don't really see any new questions in this. I'm not sure. Great. All right. I'm glad I covered all your questions. All right. Well, if there are no further questions, it is 8:51. We've been going for about 50 minutes. And I don't see any other questions on the screen. I don't see any new questions in the slides. So we'll call it a night. I know some of you have an AP test tomorrow, so make sure you get some sleep. We have AP test on Wednesday or Friday. As I used to tell our track and cross country athletes, the night before is an important night of sleep. So if you got an AP test on Friday, don't stay up cramming tonight because you'll need tonight's sleep just as much as you'll need tomorrow night's sleep for your AP exam. But thank you for those who participated. Thanks for those who added questions to the slides. If you have more questions, there'll be other review sessions taking place during and after school. But have a good night. Thanks for watching.